I would like to show you very quickly just a few of Schubert's magical strokes of the pen where he is able, apparently without any effort at all, to evoke a mood in the mind of the sensitive listener. There's a song, Tränenregen, Teardrops, which tells us of a young lad's love for a girl, of his hopes of winning her, and of his despair when he finds she loves another. And you know, we often find, if we've studied the words properly, we get a synopsis of the plot or story of the song in our little piano introduction. And in this song, you'll hear hope and despair expressed in these few bars. I'm sure you'll notice where hope ends and where despair creeps in. And then, for a contrast, listen to the anger and the malice in this song called Jealousy and Pride. This is really spiteful. Now, Frühlingstraum, Dream of Spring. This is just innocent and lovely, and Schubert gives you a tiny hint at the end of this introduction, which really tells you that it is springtime. Did you hear that little cuckoo? Mind you, Schubert does not underline that little effect. It's just one of those wonderful and precious jewels you find if love to search for them. Schubert can be very amusing in some of his moods. There's a song of his called Der Einsame, the Lonely One. This tells of a chap who comes back from work and says, "Now I'm home, all I want to do is to get the fire going, put on my carpet slippers, light my pipe, and sit down in my armchair, and I don't give a fig for anyone. I don't want to go out. I don't want to go to the theater. I don't want to go dancing. I don't want to see the girls." What an idiot the man is, isn't he? At all events, he's just smug, very self-satisfied. And I'm sure this accompaniment will convey to you this mood of smugness, this prim bachelor's self-sufficiency. Of course, this little figure in the bass here, that's where he's snuggling back in his armchair. There's a great song of Schubert's that I would like to talk about for a few minutes, and that is Erlkönig, the Earl King. If this song is well sung and well played, the terror of it will grip the listener by the throat. It tells of the father on his galloping horse, charging madly through the forest at dead of night, with his dying boy clasped in his arms. And the boy, in his fever, in his delirium, fancies he can see the specter of death chasing him down the forest path. Death, of course, being the Earl King. And the father tries to reassure the boy. He says, "My son, what you see there is only a wraith of mist." But he spurs his horse on quicker and quicker until at last he pulls up at his home, only to find that his boy is dead in his arms. Now this song has a most tremendous accompaniment. You hear in my right hand the galloping hooves of the horse right through the song like this. And you hear in my left hand this suggestion of the shudder of the boy as he sees this horrible spectre. I'd like to play a few bars of this accompaniment. And so on it clatters right through this terrifying song. And it's this song which brings to my mind one of the most trying problems with which the accompanist has to cope. The problem of balance, the balance of tone between the voice of the singer and the voice of the piano. Because, you see, that accompaniment is terribly difficult to play. And when I was a youngster and came across this song for the first time, I was frightened to death by the technical difficulty of it, and I seized the opportunity of going to hear a famous pianist who is going to accompany a singer in this very song. I went to the concert and sat there with a splendid view of the keyboard to try to find out how this great man managed this piano part. Well, to cut a long story short, I sat there boggle-eyed with wonder, but for all my binoculars, which were fixed on his fingers, I was unable to find out how he did it. I went home none the wiser. Couldn't sleep for thinking about it. When I suddenly came to in the early hours of the morning and remembered that there had been a singer. Now, the singer was a young fellow, hefty and strong. He had a big voice too. Working hard, he was. Red in the face, perspiring copiously. But all I could hear of the singer was... In fact, I couldn't hear him at all, you see. He was completely drowned by the pianist. Now, for some reason or other, which I've never been able to explain, singers do object to being drowned. You know, we accompanists, we can't afford to be like the famous conductor who'd been conducting an opera at Covent Garden. At the end of the performance, a friend went into the dressing room to see this great man, and he said to him, "You were simply marvellous tonight. I've never heard the orchestra play so superbly. Why, I've heard this opera some 50 or 60 times during the course of my life, but you did something with the orchestra. You brought out things in the score which I didn't know existed. It was an absolute revelation. It was really marvellous. But," he said, "I must tell you one thing. Couldn't hear the singers at all. You completely drowned them." And, Sir Thomas replied, "I know, I drowned them intentionally. I drowned them in the interest of the public." Well, we accompanists can't afford to be quite so public-spirited as that. But it's not so easy for us, because the singer stands, as I told you, in the bend of the piano, and directs his or her voice into the auditorium. The singer, therefore, will be standing almost with his back to the accompanist. This means that the audience, certainly the front half of the audience, are going to hear the singer's voice in greater volume than the accompanist. It means that an accompanist has got to use great judgment to assess how much or how little tone. I want to play to you in this connection the accompaniment to Schubert's Die. This is a great hymn of praise to God, and the piano has got to sound like an organ. It's got to give the impression of the great diapason tone of an organ rolling through a cathedral. If I were playing that song for a singer, even a singer with a big, noble voice, I could hardly hear her above the noise I'm making on the piano. With her back to me, all I shall hear from the singer is a wisp of tone. So if anybody was sitting next to me, on my left, turning the pages, he would say to himself, "This fellow is drowning the singer." But if I wanted to hear that singer properly, I should have to play the accompaniment like this. And at once, all the might, all the majesty, all the glory have gone out of the song. And more than that, the singer, whether the singer were a great singer or a less than great singer, would be unable to carry on with such flimsy support as that. She needs tremendous tonal support from the piano in a song of that nature, not only psychologically, but physically. Vocally, she needs a strong foundation of tone on which to lean, to help her through what is a tremendous test of endurance. So you can see how important it is for the accompanist to give all the support he can and yet not to drown the singer's tone. Believe me, it's quite a problem. Mind you, I'm referring now to the concert hall. This has nothing to do with a studio broadcast. In a broadcast, the problem of balance is taken out of your hands. For on the radio, the singer has one microphone and the accompanist another. And there's an expert, at least he says he's an expert, sitting in a little box, twiddling a couple of knobs, and he adjusts the balance according to his taste. Mind you, he may know nothing about music. He's able to raise the singer's volume as much as he likes, and he's able to lower the accompanist's volume almost to nothing. He loves doing that. At the end of your broadcast, you say to this chap, "How was the balance?" And he says, in fact, he admits, "It was perfect." But as I say, on the concert platform, the balance is entirely the accompanist's responsibility when he's with a singer. With a violinist or a cellist, the responsibility is shared, and the string player must be alive to this. I was rehearsing, for instance, the Brahms E minor sonata with a cellist, and there is a section where the cello is accompanying the piano. All the cellist does is this. And the piano plays the tune gently above the cello, like this. It's nice, isn't it? But it's quite spoiled if the cellist is not content to accompany the piano. I have heard the cellist sawing away and quite ruining it in this fashion. Well, cellists are always afraid that they won't be heard. There's another passage in this same Brahms sonata where the piano does this. ¶¶ I was rehearsing this with the cellist. And when we had done that, he stopped playing and he said, I say, old man, the cello has a tune there, you know. I replied, well, I'm playing very softly. I'm sure your tone comes through all right without any trouble. He said, well, you know, you can't play too softly in that part. All right, I said, let's try it again. I'll try and play it lighter if I can. So we tried again. And so on we went right through the passage. When we'd finished, I said, did you feel more comfortable then? Well, you know, old chap, you really can't possibly play too softly there. Well, I felt a bit mad at this. I clenched my teeth and I said, well, look here, let's try it again. We went right through the passage again, and this time I scarcely touched the notes. And I said, how was that? He said, well, old man, you really can't play too softly there, you know. So far as balance is concerned, I refer to this subject on one occasion in print. I said, no matter how softly we sing or how softly we play, we must make sure our softest tones reach the back of the hall. Not because the music critics are sleeping in the back row, but because if our tone does reach the back of the hall, everybody in the hall will have heard it. And Ernest Newman, the great critic, took me to task over this. He said, Gerald Moore is quite mistaken if he thinks we critics are sleeping in the back row. I would like to assure Mr. Moore that I've tried hard for years to get to sleep during concerts, but I've failed miserably. But I think I must tell you of an experience I had when the whole problem of balance was summed up for me in a most wonderful way. This was the first time I'd ever been engaged to play at an important concert, and also the first time I'd ever played for a really famous singer. I was very young, very nervous, and very inexperienced. And this prima donna was a terrifying woman. She was tall and stately, like Tennyson's Maud. But unlike Tennyson's Maud, she was more, a great deal more, than 17. 17 stone, perhaps. A 240-pounder, if you like. But at all events, she was terrifying. She wore a glittering tiara. She had a long train. In fact, she had everything, and literally everything, that goes with a great prima donna. She took up her stand in the bend of the piano, and I waited for her to give me the signal to start the introduction to the first song. After what seemed an eternity, she swung her regal torso in my direction and gave me a frigid nod. And I was just going to begin when she suddenly leaned across the piano and she hissed at me, "Not too loud!" Well, you know, that rather shook me. I didn't know artists talked on the platform like that. I have since found out differently. But as I say, it shook me. So I said to myself, keep calm, take your time, don't get flustered. Everything will be all right if you don't worry. Just take it easy. You see, I was just having a private tussle with myself. And I suppose she wondered what was going on, because I saw her out of the corner of my eye making impatient signs for me to start again. And once again, I prepared to start. See, I hadn't played a note yet, you see. But she was at me again, and this time she hissed, but not too soft. Well, do you know, for a long time, I hated that poor lady. But now that I've got a little older, I look back on that experience with gratitude, because it really was a masterly summing up of the way to obtain a perfect balance. There it is in a nutshell. Not too loud and not too soft. Another problem that comes the way of the accompanist is something called transposition. Now, some of you might not know exactly what transposition is, but you will when I finish with you, I can assure you. First of all, transposition is this. The accompanist sees a piece of music in front of him in one key, and he plays it in another. Intentionally, of course, intentionally. For argument's sake, suppose the music in front of me were "All the Lads, They Smile at Me When Coming Through the Rye." We'll say it's in the key of C major. Perhaps I'm asked to transpose it from C major to F sharp major. I still see it on the page in C major because the printed notes don't change. I have to change these notes in my head. So that instead of having this, we have this. And if you think that coming through the rye from C major to F sharp major, if you think that emerging from the rye that all the lads are still smiling, you're vastly mistaken. What happens, to put it bluntly, is this. The accompanist's eyes register the key of C major, but in his brain the notes are changed, and by some magic on the accompanist's part, the music comes out in a different key. Well, I don't want to go into the difficulties involved in transposing. I want to show you how transposing affects the listener without his being aware of it. There's a song by Schubert called Im Frühling, In the Springtime. In one section of this song, the piano gives you a delicious effect of a little rippling stream, birds twittering, buds gleaming in the sunshine. Here it is, in the original key of G. A lovely tinkling sound, full of sunshine and brightness. Sometimes, the singer will say, I find that key too high. Will you please play it a tone down in F? And I want you to notice a very subtle change in the quality of sound when the song is taken from here and played here. There's a slight difference, you know. A little of the brightness and buoyancy has gone out of the music. But when you transpose it even further away from Schubert's original key, this difference in the quality of sound becomes more obvious. There's very little glow left. A year or two ago, I had to play this song down a fourth. Instead of in G, I had to play it in D. And this is what it sounded like. Now, it's become heavy and dull and grey. The brightness and the sheen have gone from it, and that is how, unsuspectingly, the listener is affected by transposition. Because you may go to a concert where this lovely song is on the programme, and perhaps you play it yourself, or perhaps a friend plays it, and you say, what a delicious song, how nice it'll be to hear that song this evening. And you go to the concert. But perhaps Im Frühling is being sung in a transposed key, and you're disappointed, and you don't know why. It doesn't occur to you, and why should it, that the song has been transposed. All you say to yourself is, well, I'm not so thrilled with that song and its lovely accompaniment as I expect it to be. I don't think Moore is as good as I thought he was. He's certainly not as good as he thinks he is. Well, this is one of the burdens the accompanist has to bear without advertisement and without complaint. He can't stand up and explain to the audience that he's playing the song in a transposed key. But it's not only transposing down that can upset the song. Transposing up can have its disadvantages too. Take a song that is full of muscle and masculinity, like Brahms's Der Schmied, the blacksmith. Now, this is a weighty affair. This is how it goes. Schmied is transposed up. This is the effect you get. Well, at once you can see that the blacksmith has turned into a tinsmith. Anyway, these are instances where the listener's enjoyment is affected by transposition. Talking of transposing, I must tell you of an actual experience of mine. A bass singer came to rehearse with me. He could only speak a few words of English. We got on splendidly. One of the songs he had on his program was Der Einsame, the lonely one, the song which I spoke about earlier, you know, the smug man, the abominable smug man. Anyway, we went right through the song in the original key of F. Evidently, he found that key a little bit uncomfortable because he turned to me and said, "Is too high." I said, "Is too high?" He said, "Is too high." You see, the conversation was becoming quite animated. "Well," I said, "I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll put it down half a tone. So instead of having it in F, we'll have it in E. Instead of here, we'll have it here." We went right through it again. This time he turned to me and he said, "Is too low." I said, "Is too low?" You see, I was beginning to cotton on to the language myself by this time. He said, "Is too low." "Well," I said, "I don't know what the dickens I can do about it." And I showed him with my finger. I first of all played it in this key in F. Then I played it in this key, E. And he looked at these two notes for a long time. And then he said, "Have you nothing in between?" Well, I don't know whether he expected me to play on the cracks or not, I'm sure. Perhaps he expected me to do this. I hope that what I've said and played has convinced you that the field of the accompanist is wonderfully interesting and varied. Take my advice. When a song is being performed, open your ears and your minds impartially to what the singer and the accompanist are saying to you.